It's working. Good. So, é prazer estar aqui com vocês. Eu falo pouco de português, but unfortunately, not enough to do a presentation in Portuguese today. Not yet, not yet. Maybe in the future. I'm working. So, what I'd like to do today is try to bring together a lot of the ideas that were discussed today. It's been really amazing being here and being inspired by all the different things that people have been working on and trying to make their dreams become reality and working so hard around the world and here in Brazil. So what I'd like to do is talk about entrepreneur ecosystems, about what it really means to be an entrepreneur and how to make these things possible. Because it's become really important to me. And I want to start by talking about my personal history with entrepreneurship, because that's really formed a lot of my beliefs and how I think and what it means to really be an entrepreneur. So I grew up with entrepreneurship. My dad is an entrepreneur. He has a business in the US building houses in the construction industry. So basically from the time I was born, I've been surrounded by entrepreneurship. And I've always been fascinated by the idea of creating something from nothing. Like just like my father does, he takes an empty piece of ground and builds a beautiful house from it that didn't exist before for someone to live in. So for me, following my father's example, I started different businesses as when I was growing up as a kid. But it really wasn't until after I graduated from university that I had my first larger scale experiences with entrepreneurship. And in college, I studied a lot about globalization. I was really fascinated by the process of how things change and what factors lead to different situations developing in the world. And so in doing that, I studied a lot about China. I was actually really curious about the changes that were happening there. So soon after I graduated, I packed my bags and I moved to Beijing, to China, where I lived for 2 years. And actually, I met Benjamin this morning, and we lived two blocks from each other in Beijing. With that, we didn't even know each other. People always say the world is small. It's really small, right? So in China, I had an amazing time living there, and I quickly started different businesses using my entrepreneurial spirit in any opportunity that I thought was a really good opportunity. So I started a business in electronic product manufacturing, international trade consulting. I started a business to import coffee into China from South America. And the main business I worked on was a business to develop solar chargers that I sold to people in the US and also donated to people in developing countries where they don't have access to electricity because they could really change people's lives. So I was using business to do a lot of different things and doing what I'd always really dreamed of, right? I was 22 years old, living in China, making deals and negotiating in Mandarin Chinese, and sending products around the world, and doing things that just were really inspiring to me, right? I was really happy with what I do. I mean, just look in the picture, look how happy I was, right? Unfortunately, as I think what often happens with entrepreneurship, things don't quite work out the way that you think that they will, right? Because you try some things and things change. So despite having some initial success and some of my businesses worked okay, it eventually became a situation where everything that could have gone wrong did go wrong, right? Which, you know, happens sometimes. So I had technical problems with some of my products. I had to refund a lot of orders. There was one time when I sent a large order of money to a manufacturing company to make a huge production run, and I got a call the next day saying, we're actually bankrupt now, sorry. So a lot of difficult things happened, and eventually it got to the point where I ran out of money, right? I'd invested all my personal savings into these businesses, and I ran out of money, and I had to borrow money from my mom just to pay for my living expenses, right? So it was a hard situation, right? I had all these dreams, and they came crashing down, and I was faced with reality. But it was also an interesting time. Like I really used the experience to think about what did I learn, and how could I become better, right? And so I realized that even though I'd done some things right, I needed to learn more. So I decided to move to the place in the world that's most famous for entrepreneurship, to Silicon Valley. So a few years ago, I moved to Silicon Valley. And just a couple days after I moved there, right as I moved there, a friend invited me to go to an event. And I met a couple people starting an organization called Singularity University. And I'd never heard of it before. I was like, huh, it's kind of a funny name. I wonder what they're doing there. And I found out about the mission. And the mission is to inspire, assemble, and educate leaders and teach them about new technologies so that they can positively impact a billion people, right? A billion people. Wow, that's huge. I'd never heard of something that big before. And I was like, where can I sign up, right? How can I get involved? And I knew that something, I mean, it's located at NASA. This is Singularity University right here, at a NASA research facility in Silicon Valley. And Singularity University has partnerships with Google, Cisco, Nokia, Autodesk, and other companies in Silicon Valley. So I knew it couldn't be completely crazy if these different organizations were involved. So I said, you know, how can I get involved? And I volunteered at the beginning, doing a lot of the audiovisual work for the first program, because I joined right as the organization was being started for the first program. And so I did all the presentation work for the first program, making sure the projectors work, the audio, all the microphones work, helping organize speakers, which is a huge challenge. Actually, it's not as easy as it looks. So thank you guys very much to everyone in the back. It's really, it takes a lot of effort. I know to make everything work. And so it's been really amazing being there for the last couple of years, seeing how the model has evolved. And now my focus is doing a lot of the business development and setting up programs, especially in other countries, and trying to take what we're doing in Silicon Valley and spread it around the world. So Singularity University is really focused on bringing together groups of people. Actually, Everson is somewhere in this picture up here. We bring people together from around the world and teach them about the fastest moving technologies. So things that are happening in biotechnology, medicine, robotics, artificial intelligence, energy. Like, what are the things that are really changing the world and what's predicted over the next 3, 5, 10 years? And then we work with them to develop ideas and products and businesses that they can spin out of the programs to actually create companies to impact the world in areas like water, food, energy, education. So looking at the biggest problems that exist in the world and trying to find new solutions to solve them. And so it's been really fascinating being a part of this. And the way that we're doing this is trying to learn taking some of the best practices that exist in Silicon Valley and also other places in the world to create this ecosystem of innovation and people trying and doing new things. So having lived in Silicon Valley for the last couple of years, it's been really interesting trying to analyze what makes Silicon Valley work and how does that contrast against my experience in China, right? I tried things in China, but what was it that could have improved what I had done there? What is it that it really takes to build a successful company, and how does that happen in Silicon Valley? So it's been really interesting being in Silicon Valley. One of the main lessons I've learned is that sharing your ideas is one of the key things that makes Silicon Valley work, right? It's really being open, talking to people. Like in Silicon Valley, it's hard to even go out of my house without hearing people talking about their startup, whether it's in a cafe, or it's on the street walking down the sidewalk. Everyone is talking about and sharing their ideas, because successful entrepreneurs know that you need to work with people to get things done and improve what you're doing. Now, one example is I know a biotech company in Silicon Valley that just at a conference a few years ago, the technology people were trying to start a company, and they were talking to people about their idea at a conference. And someone connected them to an entrepreneur and an investor. They met, and then boom, the company went from being in someone's garage just a few years ago to now being in a huge biotechnology lab with over 50 people trying to commercialize their technology. So it's amazing how things change so quickly if you just are open. It contrasts a lot to my time in China. I remember specifically one time I was at a cafe in Beijing, and I was talking to one of my best friends who still lives there about the solar company I was trying to start. And I was telling him about my business idea, and he was getting really excited, right? He was like, oh man, your product's amazing. You're gonna do really well. You're gonna make a lot of money. And he was talking really loud, getting really excited. And of course, that made me happy, right? To see that my friend thought what I was doing was a good job. But I asked him, like, can you talk a little bit softer? Like, because there were other people in that cafe, and I didn't want anyone else to hear what we were talking about, because I was afraid that someone was going to hear my idea or try to copy my business, which was completely the opposite way I should have been thinking. I should have asked him to speak louder, right? To say as much as possible so that someone else, maybe in that cafe, could have helped me. Or maybe there was a solar energy expert that was sitting at the table next to us who could have been my co-founder. Who knows, right? So that's one of the things that really makes Silicon Valley really a special place, is because of the culture and the way of thinking that exists there. Another factor that I've really, when you look at successful ecosystems, not even just with business, but just in general. Another factor is diversity, which I'll get into. So if you look at natural ecosystems, a great example is a rainforest, just like the Amazon that exists here in Brazil. Like, what makes these systems in nature really successful? And it's diversity, right? And just like in a rainforest like this, you see all the big trees from the outside, just like you see big companies in Silicon Valley. But what are the dynamics that are really happening inside? In rainforests, you have thousands and millions of species that are all working together, right? And each one specializes in a very specific area. And not one species in one of these biodiversity systems lives without the support of the other species, right? They all work together in networks where they help each other, and then they survive based on the mutual benefit that they have. And the more diversity you have, the more species you have, the more they all work together, and the more life, and the richer the ecosystem is. So it's the same way in Silicon Valley. In Silicon Valley, you have lots of people from around the world coming to Silicon Valley and adding new perspectives. Over 50% of the successful companies in Silicon Valley are started by foreigners. I think that's really surprising. I just found that out recently. So over half the companies are started by people who come to Silicon Valley with their dream, with their idea, and they plug it into the culture that exists there of open collaboration and sharing, and that's what enables them to be successful. So I think it's really interesting. The third factor that I want to talk about, just with successful ecosystems, is actually a historical example. In college, I studied a lot about history and globalization, like trying to understand what situations lead to different scenarios in the world. And one of the most interesting is actually here in Sao Paulo in Brazil. This is a picture from the early 1900s in Sao Paulo. And during the late 1800s and early 1900s, and learning about the history of Brazil, there was a time when a lot of entrepreneurs and business people in Brazil realized that a lot of the manufactured products in Brazil were being imported from Europe, which was a problem because it created huge trade imbalances, right, which is an economic problem in Brazil at the time. So they decided to invest in companies in Brazil to create a domestic manufacturing industry. And this happened at the same time of a huge wave of immigration with people coming from Europe, from Asia, from the Middle East, from all over the world coming to Sao Paulo. So you had these two factors happening, right? You had entrepreneurs trying new things, and you had networks of people coming here from other countries working in teams because of the immigrant communities that developed here to build new businesses. And that's what's transformed Sao Paulo into the vibrant economic center of Brazil that it is today. So again, this contrasts a lot with my time in China. In China, I was 22 years old and doing all these international businesses, or especially in my head, doing things on a really large level. And at the time, I felt really cool. I felt really special because I was doing that, because there weren't very many entrepreneurs in China who were going out into the middle of nowhere, visiting these factories, working with these businesses in China. And because that wasn't very common, a lot of the business owners in China thought that I represented some huge company back in the US. So they took me to fancy business lunches and dinners. They gave me a really special treatment. They drove me around everywhere. And I was 22. I mean, it felt amazing, right? I thought I was really, really special. But in reality, I was by myself. I was alone. And I realized now that having that dynamic of working with people, working in teams, sharing ideas, and sharing energy with people is really essential to starting businesses. And at the time, I didn't realize that. And any time we pretend that we don't need that, that we're doing things in isolation, is when we pretend we're not being human, and we're all human, right? It's really essential to have these strong networks. So the things that I talked about today, about sharing your ideas, having diverse perspectives, and strong networks, I think are the three really essential things that you need to have a strong entrepreneur ecosystem, right? And that's why organizations that support this, like the accelerator programs here in Brazil or the Unreasonable Institute that Daniel talked about earlier today, I think are really essential for making these things happen. Because by doing this, this is what creates this dynamic. So to finish, to kind of wrap things up overall and to finish my talk, I want to talk about something that really impacted me in a huge way just a few months ago. At one of our programs in Silicon Valley at Singularity University, we had a presentation by a doctor who came. And this doctor, he works a lot with cancer patients who are really at the end of their life, nearing their death, right? It's a hard job. And he was explaining that as people are close to dying, the things that they have the most difficulty with are their regrets. right? They think about the things that they didn't do in their lives that were important to them, but they just never got around to it, or they couldn't figure out the right way to do it, and they didn't do it before they died. And that really had a profound impact on me, because I know now that looking back on my life in the future, if I haven't done all the things that I think are really important, that's going to be really difficult for me. And so I encourage you to think along those same lines of what is it that's important to you and meaningful for you that you should do in your life. And what I think this means for entrepreneurship is that I think for me almost the definition of being an entrepreneur is having a dream and trying to make that reality, right? That's what entrepreneurship is about. And I think for a lot of people, if they don't make that happen, if they're not able to fulfill that in their lifetime, they'll have regrets at the end of their life. And through building these entrepreneur ecosystems, that's what's really what really enables entrepreneurship to happen. That's what I was missing when I was in China. So by all working together, creating these networks all around the world to make entrepreneurship happen, we're working together to fulfill all of our dreams and make a better future for all of us. Thank you.